I'm Scott Walker, and this is Walks on the Wild Side. In this video, I'm going to show you how anyone of any level of experience can take beautiful photos of waterfowl. Welcome back to Walks on the Wild Side, the channel where I help you capture the beauty of nature through your lens. In this video, we're going to talk about waterfowl, and something I often get asked when people see my photos of waterfowl is, how long did it take you to do that in Photoshop? And let me tell you, none of these photos are Photoshopped. This is all achieved in camera. And what's more, absolutely anyone can do it. It's one of the easiest things to do in wildlife photography. Now, even if you've not taken many wildlife photos yet, perhaps you're still shooting in auto mode, you can do this. And it's really easy. Three steps. Step number one, have a camera with a longish lens. Step number two, find a pond or a lake where the ground is level with the water. Step number three, have the most relaxing day of wildlife photography you'll ever experience, because you're going to be lying on your belly. For most people, photographing ducks and geese are amongst their first steps in wildlife photography because it's so accessible. Anywhere you are, you're going to be near a pond or a lake, and you're going to be able to see mallards, coots, grey-lag geese, Canada geese, and all sorts of regional variations. So it's a great way to start, but do people always know the best way to go about doing it? Most people begin photographing birds on water by standing at the water's edge and pointing their camera down at the bird. But you get photos like this, where there's no interesting background, the water is all in focus, so it's distracting, and your eye is constantly moving around and doesn't really have anywhere to settle or focus on. It's neither beautiful or interesting. Why is this? Remember that the plane of focus, which is the part of the photo that is perfectly sharp, is always parallel to your camera's sensor. And you want to focus on the bird's head, or ideally its eye. And then you have an area either side of the plane of focus, which is acceptably in focus. In this situation, it's mainly dictated by which aperture you use. And this area is called the depth of field. Everything inside it is fairly well in focus, and so the water surrounding the bird and behind it is not blurred out. If we change our position and get down on the ground, you get photos like these. This is the same coot, and the photo was taken a few seconds apart from the previous one with the same camera settings. All that has changed is that I'm lying on the ground instead of being stood up. You can see the coot's environment, but it's not distracting. The water is all blurred out, except for that which is in the plane of focus. Your eye comes to rest on the bird, which is what you want, instead of being distracted by the water ripples around it. It's a much more attractive photo, and it puts you in the bird's world instead of looking down upon it. Why does this work? Well, the same as before, the plane of focus is parallel to the camera sensor, and there's a depth of field around the bird. But there's nothing in that area except for the bird, and so almost everything in the picture is blurred out. So the same bird at the same time with the same settings from a different position. Which is better? Clearly, it's the photo taken at water level. Next, because the background is in focus, we need to think about that background. And remember that lens compression with longer focal lengths means that the background appears much closer to your subject than it actually is. So when you've got trees, bushes, grasses, etc. at the far side of the pond, you want to make sure that the distance between your subject and the background is at least double the distance from your sensor to the subject. Then all you need to do is make sure your camera is as close to the water's surface as possible. And that way you'll cut over all the water and smooth it out. You can make the water look like it's a duck gliding over silk. Let's look at some basic examples. When you're starting out, just try and get your subject in the centre of the frame and leave a sufficient distance in front of them to get nice blurred out water. Make sure that your focusing point is on the bird's head or eye. And if you're shooting in auto mode, pick a bird that isn't moving particularly fast. Your camera will do a good job in this scenario, but it won't if the bird is swimming fast across the water. If you're shooting in manual, aperture priority or shutter priority, you'll be amazed how slow a shutter speed you can get away with. I can go down as low as 1/150th of a second. Once you get used to this, try offsetting your bird to one side of the photo. It's always nice to leave some negative space in front of your bird to allow your viewer to imagine them swimming into that space. And you don't need to be wide open. In fact, having a wide open aperture can cause parts of the bird to be slightly less in focus if they're at an angle to you. F8 or F9 is great for shots like these. Sometimes you might want to fill much more of the frame with your bird, particularly if it's a big bird that you're photographing, such as a goose. But you still want to make sure you leave some negative space for movement. It's just a much nicer picture and you leave more space for the water to blur around the bird. Sometimes you'll find the birds rearing up out of the water. Think about going for a portrait orientation for shots like these. If you don't, you'll leave too much space to the left or the right of the bird, and because the bird's not moving, you don't need to leave negative space for them to move into.
Now you want to make sure you've got something soft to lie on, like a camping mat. And that's to keep you warm and dry, but also for hygiene reasons. You can probably see that I'm surrounded by quite a lot of goose poo, and in all honesty, it's quite stinky. But when it's this easy to take beautiful photographs, you've got to suffer for your art somehow.
You can get different colours in the water by moving around the pond and photographing birds that are nearer the edges, which reflect whatever is surrounding the water. This juvenile moorhen was photographed on another day against some background grasses which are reflecting into the water. This mallard was photographed today with some of the dark green trees surrounding the pond, and that background is also reflected in the water. You can also use anything on the water's surface, such as feathers or leaves. I got this photo in a section of the pond where there were a lot of floating swan feathers. It gives this lovely effect of bokeh across the water's surface and behind the bird, which makes something a little bit different than the photos we've discussed so far. You can also look for any flowers that surround the pond to give some nice background colours and which will add some variety to your photos.
Hey, look here. On this rock just behind me, we've got an Egyptian goose. Now, Egyptian geese were revered in Egypt as sacred, and they painted them on their tombs because they thought that they would guard their cattle. And you might look at them and think, well, actually, they look kind of Egyptian. But actually, the Egyptians looked like the geese because they painted their eyes to look like the Egyptian geese, which isn't called an Egyptian goose in Egypt. They're called the Nile goose. But people brought them over to England to be pets in country houses. And for some reason, they didn't think, oh, it's a bird, it can fly off. And many of them escaped and got into the wild. And you'll see them quite a lot around East Anglia and along the Thames Valley. But they're also creeping now into other parts of the country, and it looks like we've got a few here.
Finally, let's think about some action shots. When the birds rise up out of the water to shake it off, the amazing thing is that you still don't need too fast a shutter speed. The reason is that once a bird has risen up into position,
It keeps its head and body fairly still and just moves its wings fast. So this coot was photographed at 1/200th of a second, and whilst there's some wing movement, its head and body are pretty well sharp. This mallard was photographed at 1/400th of a second, and its head is tack sharp, whilst its wing and the water splashes show some lovely motion.
So this method is so simple, anyone can achieve this beautiful look when photographing waterfowl. If you're new to wildlife photography and maybe want to give this a go for the first time, let me know how you get on and tell me what you think. If you've enjoyed today's video, please hit the like button and don't forget to subscribe so that you get notified of future content. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.